Okay, hi everybody, my name is Sarah Barnes. Thank you so much for sticking around. I promise it'll be worth your while. So I'm gonna be speaking to you about the impacts of lake level decline on tuijub, which is a critical forage species for native Lahontan cutthroat trout in Pyramid Lake, Nevada. Global freshwater biodiversity is imperiled by thermal and hydrologic regime change, pollution, and non-native species introductions, which at this point should be very familiar to you. Terminal saline lakes in arid regions experience biogeochemical changes and littoral habitat loss from drought and water diversions. And when I say terminal lakes, endorheic lakes, these are lakes that have inflow but no outflow and primarily lose water through evaporation, like the Great Salt Lake. Pyramid Lake is one such large deep terminal lake on Pyramid Lake Paiute tribe land in Nevada. It is home to the world-renowned fishery for threatened Lahontan cutthroat trout, which is of great social, cultural, and economic importance to the Pyramid Lake Paiute tribe. Primary water input comes from the Truckee River, which is highlighted in red in the upper right. And the lake level has declined as a result of dam construction and diversions of the Truckee River. So the Truckee River begins at Lake Tahoe and then runs 121 miles down to Pyramid Lake, and is diverted by many dams all along that. So the Derby Dam was the first dam constructed, and many more have preceded since. The lake level has declined 25 meters from 1867, as you can see from this gauge report. And then just anecdotally, if you look on the pyramid, you can see former lake elevation levels. Lahontan cutthroat trout were largely extirpated from the lake in 1940 due to this dam construction and water diversion, and also overfishing. So you can see this kid was having a little bit too good of a day. In 2014, concerted multi-agency conservation efforts, including hatchery program, water management to mimic natural flow regimes, led to the first natural spawning event of Lahontan cutthroat trout in the Truckee River in roughly a century, which is of course very exciting. And LCT's success, continued success in Pyramid Lake, relies on their primary forage species, the tuijub. This native predator-prey relationship remains tightly linked despite stocking of Lahontan cutthroat trout and these changes to the environment, which is rather rare. So the next natural step in LCT recovery is to manage for tuijub, which is where my project comes in. So tuijub are a large-bodied, short-lived minnow. They're found primarily in lac estuarine habitats, but also small streams, all over the Intermountain West, as you can see from this range map. They're opportunistic omnivores. They spawn in summer in the littoral zone, and they sexually mature at 2 to 3 years of age. This graph shows you years on the x-axis from 1983 to 2021, and then log transform tuijub CPUE from gillnet surveys over this time period, adjusted up one to show zero values. And then this black line gives you the mean, and the gray shading shows you 95% confidence interval. And from this data, we can see that tuijub mean CPUE has decreased 73% from 1983, concordant with this lake level decline. So the main goal of my research project is to understand by what mechanism might lake level decline affect tuijub abundance in Pyramid Lake. And I'm going to look at two primary mechanisms. So the first one is changes to littoral habitat, and the second is changes to total dissolved solids. So total dissolved solids are a big deal in these endorheic lakes. I think of them as a bathtub. And so they're sitting there, and as this water gets evaporated out, if you don't have equal inflow of water to evaporation of water, those solutes, the number of solutes stay the same. And so as that water comes out, you concentrate it. And fish and other aquatic organisms have some sort of total dissolved solid tolerance range. And when you exceed that tolerance range, they can experience physiological stress and ultimately mortality. So my first hypothesis is that lake level decline will decrease tuijub littoral spawning and rearing habitat, thereby decreasing spawning and recruitment success. So as you can see, the littoral habitat, as that lake level draws down, gets smaller. Second hypothesis, lake level decline will increase total dissolved solid concentrations in the lake, increasing physiological stress on tuijub and decreasing their fitness. So I will look at these hypotheses with three objectives. First objective, quantify changes in available littoral habitat with lake elevation decline. Second, determine tuijub spawning and rearing littoral habitat preference, so understand which aspects of the littoral habitat they are using the most in Pyramid Lake. And then assess tuijub early life responses to increasing total dissolved solid concentrations. I've chosen to look at early life responses simply because that's where I suspect they will feel the impacts of total dissolved solids first, which will act sort of like a bottleneck on their population. Objective one. So I will answer this objective by first creating an elevation explicit model of Pyramid Lake, which in theory is fairly simple. Take lake elevation data, subtract depth, and get lake bed expressed as a function of elevation. And once you have lake bed expressed as a function of elevation, you can choose different lake bed or lake elevation levels and understand the bathymetry at those elevations. From this elevation explicit model, I will calculate littoral area at different elevation scenarios. I'll do this using ArcGIS spatial analysis tools, and I'll generate 6 elevation scenarios to look at change in littoral habitat across those scenarios. First will be the highest known lake elevation that we have, so that 1867 number. Then present day lake elevation, minus 25% of historical decline. So taking 25% of that 25 meters, subtracting it from present day and looking at how the littoral area will change. Minus 50%, minus 75%, and ultimately minus 100% of historical decline. Once I have all these scenarios, I will model the change in the littoral area across the scenarios to understand how lake drawdown will continue to affect available littoral habitat for tui chub spawning and rearing. My second objective will be to determine tui chub spawning and rearing littoral habitat preference. So what specific habitat metrics within that littoral habitat are tui chub using the most? I will do this by sampling fish and habitat at 9 sites across the lake. 8 of these sites have been used by Utah State University and other institutions over time to look at different fish and habitat metrics. And then I will add 1 new site at the inflow of the Truckee River, which is a particularly unique shallow habitat within Pyramid Lake. Each site will be sampled once a month from May through August, which we suspect is their spawning and rearing season. And this will be done in 2022 and 2023, so 2 field seasons. The fish sampling will be done with a variety of methods. I will sample larval fish, so to answer that rearing question, with the larval net toes pulled at 10, 20, 30, and 60 meters of depth. And then I will sample spawning adult fish with 32 paired minnow traps, and then 3 pelagic trap nets and 3 weighted gill nets set in series with each other to understand how they're distributed throughout the water column. I've chosen to go out to 30 meters of depth as a conservative estimate of where the littoral zone will end. So we don't have a good idea of exactly where the littoral zone ends in Pyramid Lake, which is something I will be working on in my first season using a combination of macrophyte vegetation data and also euphotic data. So the 30 meters is just to use a conservative estimate of where that littoral zone will end. I will sample a variety of habitat metrics, including substrate and vegetation, temperature, conductivity, and clarity. I will sample substrate and vegetation with hydroacoustics, ground truth with scuba surveys, and then I will set out multiple temperature loggers at each site and sample conductivity and clarity at each site when we do fish sampling. The analyses I see for this section of the project would be to model abundance distribution of tui chub both across the lake and throughout time within that spawning and rearing season using habitat metrics as predictors, and then map this spatial and temporal abundance distribution using something like a heat map. My third objective is to assess tui chub early life responses to increasing total dissolved solid concentrations in Pyramid Lake. So I'll do this using a controlled experiments run at the same time as my field sampling out at Pyramid Lake. And the aim of these experiments will be to challenge tui chub eggs to increasing levels of total dissolved solid concentrations, and then look at differences in their survival, growth, and hatch out. I will start with Truckee River total dissolved solid levels, which is as close to fresh as tui chub would ever experience, and then use a gradient of treatments up to a level of total dissolved solids that's believed to be lethal to tui chub from observations at Walker Lake, which is a similar lake to Pyramid that is now devoid of fish, but used to have a very similar fish composition and environment as Pyramid Lake. So the first step in these experiments will be to create high total dissolved solid water through evaporation. So to get as close to the natural process as possible, I will set water troughs of Pyramid Lake water out in the sun allow the water to evaporate off and create that high total dissolved solid water. Second, I will capture gravity chub and then place them into their respective treatments and acclimate them to these treatments. So I'll start, like I said, at the Truckee River water and then go all the way up to 15,400 milligrams per liter, which we believe will be lethal to any eggs that we put in it. And the idea behind going from fresh water all the way up to a believed lethal level is to see any subacute effects. So we know that at a certain level, total dissolved solids will kill these fish, but to understand if maybe there are some subacute effects on survival and growth that may account for that decrease in abundance that we're already seeing potentially at the total dissolved solid level that they're already at in Pyramid Lake. And then the third step will be to spawn these acclimated individuals. So I'll have 4 males and 2 females, ideally for each experiment. The 2-to-1 ratio is pretty common in hatcheries, so we're just gonna go with that. And mix them into one vessel to try to minimize the genetic effect on differences in survival and growth across the treatments. Spawn them into one vessel, evenly divide the eggs out by weight, and then place them into their respective replicates. So there will be 5 replicates for each treatment group. This would represent 1 treatment group, and there are 5 treatment groups total. And then the last step will be to observe these eggs for 120 days. So the goal would be for these eggs to hatch out and then observe any larvae for differences in survival and growth, and then obviously observe the eggs for differences in hatch out rate and percent hatch out to understand what effect these treatments may be having. Potential analyses I see for this section of the experiment would be a survival curve, showing differences in survival across days and then across the full 120-day period, and then an ANOVA analysis to look at differences in those parameters, survival and growth across treatment groups. Management implications I see from the results of this study primarily would be to understand the water needs for tui chub in Pyramid Lake. Second would be to align LCT stocking regimes with tui chub carrying capacity. So using this early on sampling of tui chub in the summer season, using these larval net tows to get an earlier idea of adult tui chub abundance to be able to base our LCT stocking regimes off of, so we don't decouple that relationship. And we keep LCT from exceeding the carrying capacity of tui chub and potentially collapsing that population. And then lastly would be to protect critical tui chub spawning areas. So Pyramid Lake is huge, know which areas of Pyramid Lake tui chub are using the most and try to protect those from foot traffic, which can be very heavy at Pyramid Lake. Before I take any questions, I just want to thank all the people who have helped me already on this project, particularly the Pyramid Lake Paiute Tribe, who's been extremely supportive of this work, very helpful with their comments, particularly Dan Mosley, who's the executive director of the fisheries board there, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for both funding and field support, my major advisor, Professor Phaedra Booty with the USGS Utah Cooperative Fish and Wildlife Unit, my other advisor, Dr. Rabat Altokichi with the Rocky Mountain Science Center, Professor Janice Brainy for all of her help here in the Department of Waters and Sciences, Ecology Center, and of course, Gary Thede. With that, I can take any questions. What's up, Barrett? Yes. It's monomictic. Yeah, I don't know exactly where it is. I imagine it changes. Some of the lake is extremely shallow and then some is extremely deep. So it may be earlier on in like the east side that's extremely deep rather than the west side that has more shallow habitat. Yeah, I don't know exactly. Nick? I bet trout LCT eat tui chub eggs, but I don't know specifically. Yeah. The other studies that have looked at like tui chub spawning and rearing have been in somewhat different lakes, but they mostly find them in vegetation, like attached to vegetation. They're demersal. But I don't know if anyone's actually observed them being eaten by anything in Pyramid, but yeah. But there's not as much vegetation in Pyramid Lake as other lakes where it's been observed. So I don't know if they're using the same strategy in Pyramid. Yes. What do you mean? Oh, yeah, I should have put that graph up. But yes, there's a pretty direct relationship between decline in elevation and increase in total dissolved solids. I don't know when they started measuring it, but I do have a graph that shows. Yeah. Yeah, it used to be around 4,800 and now it's at 5,400. Yeah, if that gives you some context. Yeah. Yeah.
Are there any politics surrounding like minimum flows?
Yeah. Yes, a lot. The Truckee River is extremely diverted. That Truckee River operating agreement is a big deal. There's like a lot of groups that are really interested in that. I know that the Pyramid Lake Paiute tribe has attempted to get like minimum, Pedro probably knows this better than I, like minimum designated flows for Pyramid Lake. But I mean, there's a ton of groups that want water out of, there's a lot of agriculture out there. There's a lot of development happening like in the Reno Sparks area and around Lake Tahoe. Everybody wants, yeah, the Truckee River's water. Yeah. Yeah.
I just want to say you brought the bingo hall energy to the final session. And the final
thank you. Session. Is it because of this shirt? Is that what you're saying? Yeah. So I wore it.
I did want to ask, where is your like capture experiment happening? Is that happening on site?
Yeah. There, it's going to be on site. Yeah, this first year is going to be pretty experimental, but yeah, because I'm capturing gravid individuals and trying to get eggs out of it, it all kind of has to happen right there next to the lake. So I'm going to try to hatch them. The Pyramid Lake Paiute Tribe Fisheries is allowing us to use some of their facilities. So yeah, Casey. Probably not. It's the same length as the field season, which is very convenient. But also, I think that it's, yeah, I think we'll find out in the first season if we'll really need 120 days. But the idea was to look at differences in growth and survival across the larvae, and that would give them enough time to kind of show that effect. Yeah. So that could be a good idea. I took this like gradient idea. There's another study that basically did this in LCT at Walker Lake, and I thought it was really interesting because they basically showed that any increase in total dissolved solid was stressing the fish. Like, I think a lot of people have thought that they had some sort of mechanism to adapt to it, but they actually don't. They're just kind of living with the stress. And so I thought it'd be interesting to see if that was happening in Tui Chub, but it could be cool to add like more smaller gradients before, instead of just looking at these really high. But I think the idea behind looking at those higher total dissolved solids is we're kind of headed that direction. And so to understand like the response there, but yeah, could add another one. Anyone else? Done.